Hello students, next let us look at some of the properties of the convolution sum. There are mainly three properties that we have to study: commutative property, associative property, distributive property. Now let us look at each one by one. First let us look at the commutative property of convolution sum. The commutative property says that if you are having a convolution sum between a function x of n and a function of h of n, then its value will be same as if you would consider to take a convolution of h of n with x of n. Just like that we have in the case of commutative property for multiplication, the same thing we can apply here also. And that is basically what is meant by the commutative property of convolution sum. Let us try to prove this. Now, by definition, we know what is x of n convolution with h of n. It is summation of x of k multiplied with h of n minus k for k is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity. Now if we change the variable, so by changing the variable and the variable that we are going to change is n minus k. So if I am going to change n minus k to m, okay, then we have the equation of x of n convolution with h of n to be summation. Now see, when I'm going to write n minus k is equal to m, then you can see that, you know, k will be equal to n minus m. You can see that, correct? You can see that. So instead of x of k, I can write x of n minus m and h of n minus k as h of m. Now what about the limit that I am having here? Here the limit k is equal to minus infinity. So have a look from this equation. If k is equal to minus infinity, then I have n minus of minus infinity, isn't it? And that will give me a value of what? N plus infinity. So the value of m is going to be equal to n plus infinity, which is infinity. So I will have k is equal to, instead of k, I will have the limit of m going from plus infinity to, if I am now going to put minus infinity, infinity plus infinity in case of this equation. So if I am going to put k is equal to plus infinity, then I am going to have n minus of infinity is equal to m. That means m is going to be minus infinity. So that minus infinity I will write here. So now the equation has changed from this to this, which I can basically, you know, rewrite it as, so summation from infinity to minus infinity is as good as writing m is equal to minus infinity to infinity, because it's just, you know, values going from minus plus infinity to minus infinity, same as going from minus infinity to plus infinity. And then I am going to put hm first. I'm just going to rearrange it so that I put hm first, and then I'm going to put x of n minus m. Now you look at these two equations here. Instead of k, what we have got is m, and the equation, rest of the equation is same. Only thing is that h and x have changed position. So this is basically the equation of h of n convolution with x of n. So instead of k, we have now having m, and that is only the change that has happened. So based on that, we can say that, you know, we started from this part and we have got this. Therefore finally I will write, you know, that hence commutative property proved. Next, I will look at the second property, which is the associative property. The associative property basically says that if you are trying to convolute x of n with h of n, let's say h1 of n, and you do that first, and then you basically try to again convolute what is the answer with another function h2 of n, its answer will be same as x of n convoluted with the convolution sum of first doing h1 of n convolution with h2 of n. So this is the associative property, which says that, you know, basically first you try to associate these two and then try to convolute with the second one. And here you are taking the first one and you are trying to convolute with the association of the next two. So is the associative property, you know, possible in the case of convolution? That is what we have to prove. So let me write the proof. Now we know that x of n convolution with h1 of n is going to be equal to, we know the equation, summation from k is equal to minus infinity to infinity of x of k multiplied with h1 of n minus k. This is the equation. Let me write this as the first equation. This is the first equation. Now let me say that the convolution, this convolution, that means x of n, so let x of n convolution with h1 of n, let this be considered as some function f1 of n. And similarly, if I consider the second function, the next two, let me write h1 of n convolution with h2 of n is equal to another function f2 of n. So I have basically defined two functions, f1 of n and f2 of n. So now if you look at this particular equation, then I can write, so you know, if I am trying to do x of n convolution, sorry, x of n convolution with h1 of n convolution with h2 of n, it is as good as writing f1 of n convolution with h1 of n, sorry, h2 of n, h2 of n, correct, which I can write, you know, by using the rule of, you know, summation, the rule of convolution, I can write this is equal to, now let me take the variable as m. So m minus infinity to infinity f1 of n, I will write it as f1 of m multiplied with h2 of n minus m, correct? And that f1 of m, that f1 of m we are going to substitute from equation 1, because, you know, f1 of m is basically this. So equation 1, if I am going to substitute, so I can write that is equal to, now let me take it in a different page. So as you can see in the previous equation where we had this f1 of m, I have substituted this f1 of m with this particular equation that you can see in this particular equation as the brown color, you know, equation that you can see here. So that is what is f1 of m that I have basically substituted, where f1 of m basically was taken from the other equation. But since, you know, I have taken it from this equation, even though I have taken it from this equation, here the variable is n, but here the variable has become m. So instead of n, I have to do a substitution of m. So that substitution I will do, otherwise I may go wrong. So that part I will do. So it is going to be m minus k. Okay. Next, I am going to, you know, put another or substitute another variable for m minus k. So I will write substituting m minus k with r. So r is equal to m minus k, and changing the order of summation, and changing the order of summation, what will I get? Changing the order of summation. Changing the order of summation, what do I get? So the first thing is that my summation of k will come outside. So I will write k is equal to minus infinity to infinity. And with that, obviously, x of k, because there is only one variable k here. And then I will write for the case of m, which, you know, it was in black color, so I will write. In black itself, I will write. So summation, now, instead of m, I am changing it with r, isn't it? So if m is equal to minus infinity, r will also be equal to minus m. So I will write r is equal to minus infinity to infinity. Okay, r is equal to minus infinity to infinity. H1 of m minus k, I am going to change it as h of r. Okay, so I should, you know, basically write that in terms of this brown color, because that is what the equation was. So h1 of r, and then multiplying it with the second one, which is h2 of, n minus m. Now here m is what? M is basically from here, from this equation, I can get m is equal to r plus k, correct? And if I have to multiply, or if I have to substitute here instead of m, I will substitute it with minus of r minus of k. So where the minus of r minus k came from? Here, where I have taken the value of m from this equation. So with that, what I will have is basically this equation, and now I have changed the order of summation also. Let me write this equation as equation number 2. Now if you would look at this equation, it is the summation of h1 and h2, which we have already previously defined here as f2, correct? Not the summation, the convolution of h1 and h2 is basically f2. So that same thing we will be using here. Okay, we will be using here. So I will write, we know. So let me use a different color. So we know that f2 of n is basically h1 of n convolution with, let me write here, yeah, h1 of n convolution with h2 of n, which is basically summation. Now suppose if I am going to use a variable r is equal to minus infinity to infinity h1 of r into h1 of n minus r. That is what we have studied as the convolution equation, correct? Instead of k, it is a variable r. Now look at these two equations. These two equations are almost similar, other than this value of 1k here, correct? So to adjust that k, you know, to adjust that k, I can say that, you know, and f2 of n minus k. So if I am going to substitute instead of n minus k, then in this particular equation, wherever there is n, there I will have to substitute it with n minus k. So I will have here, there is no change because it is h1 of r, and here instead of n, I will substitute with n minus k and then minus r. And now you can see that these two equations are similar. Which one? The one here and one in the bracket here. Both the equations are same. So I can now write, therefore, Therefore, so where I had started from, I had started in the, you know, right hand side with this particular equation. I will write that again, I will write that here. So therefore, convolution of x of n with h1 of n, convolution with h2 of n is going to be equal to, now I will write this equation. This equation is basically summation of k is equal to minus infinity to infinity x of k, and instead of the whole bracket I will substitute it with f2 of n minus k. And what is this? This is basically the convolution of x of k with f2 of n, not f of k, it is with f x of n, sorry, with x of n, convolution with f2 of n, isn't it? This equation is exactly that. Now what is f2 of n? F2 of n we have already seen. What is f2 of n? F2 of n is basically this. So all I have to do is I have to basically substitute that there. So that is equal to x of n convolution with, within bracket, h1 of n convolution with h2 of n. And that basically proves the associative property. Hence, associative property proved. Next, we will try to prove the distributive property. Next is the distributive property of convolution sum, where you can see that, you know, if we are having two functions whose addition is convoluted with x of n, it is as good as convoluting one of the functions with x of n and adding up with the convolution sum of the second function with x of n. So let us prove it. Its proof is very simple, that we know now if we want to do summation of x of n with the sum of h1 of n plus h2 of n, then it is as good as writing the equation summation k is equal to minus infinity to infinity x of k plus the combined h1 of, instead of n I will write h1 of n minus k plus h2 of n minus k. Okay, because in the second function the variable has to be changed from n to n minus k. That is what we have done here. Now I can take, you know, splitting the summation, not splitting the summation, what I will say is taking the summation inside the bracket, taking summation inside bracket, what do I get? Taking the summation inside bracket, what I get is equal to summation k is equal to minus infinity to infinity x of k with, sorry, this was not plus, this should be my multiplication. Okay, so with h1 of n minus k, then plus, you know, summation k is equal to minus infinity to infinity x of k into h2 of n minus k. So all I have done is I have opened up the bracket, that's all. I have opened up the bracket. Now you can see that what is this? This first equation is basically the convolution of x of n with h1 of n, that is the equation. And the second equation is basically the convolution of x of n with h2 of n, correct? Hence, proved. So we have proved the distributive property also.